Welcome to Hematopoiesis Part 2. In this tutorial, we'll take a close look at the different blood cell lineages and learn how to identify them under the microscope. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the Histology Wizard. In our last tutorial, we looked at the lineages of the different blood cells and examined how bone marrow was organized. But bone marrow can look a whole lot like a Where's Waldo puzzle, so how does one go about figuring out what cell is what? Well, one of the first things to remember is that hematopoiesis is complicated. And the second thing to remember is that it's a continuum. So cells are going to be in various stages of development, all squished together in that bone marrow niche. Now recall that all the mature blood cells, except for T lymphocytes, are born and mature in the bone marrow. Unfortunately, most of the stem cells look a lot like lymphocytes. And even the first committed cells of many lineages, the blast cells, all look alike, at least to our eyes. This means that most cells can't be identified by morphology, only by cell-specific markers. But today, I'll describe the cells of three lineages in detail and show you some ways to identify some of the stages in the bone marrow. Practically speaking, what does "it's complicated and it's on a continuum" actually mean when you look at bone marrow under the microscope? For one thing, it means forget about trying to identify all the cells on a bone marrow slide. You won't be able to name everything you see. What you will be able to do is to identify the stages of the erythrocyte and granulocyte lineages, as well as megakaryocytes and plasma cells. Recall that hematopoietic stem cells undergo developmental changes. Let's review these changes, and then we'll look at some of these changes in the two different lineages. First, as I discussed in the previous tutorial, developmental potential, that is, the ability of cells to give rise to different cell types, becomes more restricted as they move from stem cell to mature cell. At the same time, stem cells have the highest ability to self-renew, while most other stages lack this ability. Conversely, the ability of cells to divide increases until cells reach the blast stage, but then in later blast stages, that ability is lost. Cells also begin to take on their mature morphologies in the blast stage, but only achieve full functional abilities when they are completely mature. Now, all of these changes occur under the influence of growth factors, but stem cells and mature cells lack the ability, for the most part, to actually respond to these factors. Some of these changes are fairly easy to see under the light microscope. Cells tend to get smaller over time, and so does the nucleus, but it gets smaller more quickly. The nucleus can undergo some dramatic changes. Nucleoli are prominent in the early stages, but then they disappear, and there are chromatin changes. The shape of the nucleus can also undergo very dramatic changes, becoming multi-lobed in the granulocytes and being lost in red blood cells. The cytoplasm also changes. RNA decreases while specific contents such as granules or hemoglobin increase, so the cytoplasm of cells typically changes from a darker blue color to clear or red in mature blood cells. All of these changes together can help you tell the different lineages apart and to distinguish the different stages within those lineages. So I've just described a whole bunch of changes. Now let's take a look at a couple of the lineages where it is reasonably easy to identify the stages. Again, remember this is a continuum, so not every stage will have a name, but there are specific stages that have consistent characteristics, and that's what we'll focus on. We'll start with the erythrocyte, or red blood cell lineage. Now this lineage makes erythrocytes, or red blood cells, which are also called all sorts of different names, from normoblast, which tends to be a pathologist term, to erythrocytes, or red blood cells. Here we're looking at a developmental series from left to right, with the mature red blood cell farthest to the right. From proerythroblast to release into the blood takes about a week. As mentioned previously, the ability of these cells to divide decreases as the cells mature. And in this case, the polychromophilic erythroblast is the last cell in the lineage capable of dividing. The two cells that are normally found in the blood are the reticulocyte and the mature red blood cell. But we don't usually see reticulocytes in our blood smears due to staining and due to the fact that they mature very rapidly in the blood. Finally, erythropoietin is the major cytokine to affect this lineage, and it has its effects fairly early in the lineage, in the very early colony-forming unit until the proerythroblast stage. So that's all good, but how do we tell the cells apart? What are some of the changes that we can see as red blood cells mature? From left to right, the cells get smaller, but you can see that the nucleus gets smaller faster, and it stays round. And this is in contrast to the granulocytes we'll see soon. The nucleoli, a hallmark of the proerythroblast, disappear, the chromatin gets clumpy, and the red blood cell nucleus is extruded before the reticulocyte stage. As their name implies, the cytoplasm becomes more and more eosinophilic due to hemoglobin accumulation. These cells will circulate for about 120 days, and practically speaking, this means that treatments to restore red blood cells can take up to 3 months to be fully effective. We will quickly go through each name stage, and I'll point out some of the characteristics that help us determine that stage. First, we have the proerythroblast. This is the first recognizable stage and the least mature stage that we'll look at. They're the largest cells with very prominent nucleoli, which you can see marked with the green arrows, and they often have a thin basophilic cytoplasm. And you can also note the very large, almost oval-shaped nucleus. Next up, we have the basophilic erythroblast. By this point, the cell's lost its nucleoli. It has a smaller, very condensed nucleus, and the most basophilic dark cytoplasm of this lineage. And in some cases, the nucleus is beginning to move slightly off-center. As we move further in time and further to the right, we see the polychromatophilic erythroblast, which continues to get smaller. Its nucleus is moving more eccentric or off-center. This cell's cytoplasm can range from a pale blue to a pale gray or even slightly pink. It's the last cell to be able to divide in this lineage. The last stage not normally found in the blood is the orthochromophilic erythroblast. This cell has an eccentric nucleus and a colorless pale pink or gray cytoplasm. Late in this stage, the nucleus is ejected. So if these cells are seen in the peripheral blood, this can indicate early release of progenitors from the bone marrow and a possible pathology. Finally, we have the reticulocytes, the last stage before the mature red blood cell. At this point, the nucleus has been ejected, but the cells still contain polyribosomes used to make globin, so they only stain with a basic dye. Because of this, and because they mature very rapidly once in the circulation, we don't see these in our right stained blood smears. But reticulocyte counts are often done to determine whether red blood cells are being produced, and high counts can be indicators of pathology. The next developmental series with recognizable stages is the granulocyte series, where the final cell figures are the polymorphonuclear neutrophil, or the PMN, the eosinophil, and the basophil. In contrast to the erythrocyte lineage, granulocytes undergo very dramatic changes in nuclear shape, and they acquire granules as they mature. They also tend to have a very short lifespan. Like the erythrocyte lineage, the cells lose the ability to divide as they mature. Here, the myelocyte is the last cell capable of mitosis. Let's run through the cells in this series. We're going to take the first cells as a pair, the myeloblast and the promyelocyte. Students often confuse the myeloblast with the proerythroblast, but remember that I mentioned all blasts look somewhat alike. It does have fine chromatin and very faint nucleoli, but typically its nucleus is rounder and its cytoplasm is less blue than the proerythroblast. Promyelocyte, on the other hand, has granules, either red or magenta, but it still retains its nucleoli. But remember that from here on, the major distinguishing features are going to be those granules and the changing shape of the nucleus. The next step, the myelocyte, is much more recognizable. Here there are increasing amounts of granules, and those granules can now be seen as eosinophilic, basophilic, or neutrophilic, just like the mature blood cell types. The nucleus is now much smaller and off to the side. In this image, you can appreciate both the eosinophilic granules as well as the off-center position of the nucleus. Again, this is the last cell capable of dividing in this lineage. The metamyelocyte has increasing numbers of granules and a characteristic bean-shaped or indented nucleus that is off-center. The band form has a characteristic U-shaped nucleus. And finally, in these images, you can appreciate seeing a band-form neutrophil alongside the mature, more lobed form. The next two slides are simply summaries of first the granulocyte lineage and the comparison of the two lineages for you to review later. Now, in addition to the named stages of the erythrocyte and granulocyte lineages, you should also be able to recognize the third of the tripoietic lineages in the hematopoietic bone marrow. And that's the megakaryocyte, which will eventually give rise to platelets, and it's probably the easiest cell type to recognize in the bone marrow. The cell has a large nucleus that is highly polyploid. This is a result of endomitosis, or DNA replication without nuclear division. So this cell can be anywhere from 8 to 64N. Megakaryocytes, as the name implies, are giant cells, and those nuclei are highly lobed as seen in this image on the right. Now recall that platelets or thrombocytes will form in this process that is driven by thrombopoietin. But how are the platelets actually formed? Well, essentially, the megakaryocyte will extend long processes which will penetrate the sinusoidal capillary endothelium. And these proplatelet blebs seen here will eventually pinch off to form the platelets. I'd like to end today by discussing one important process concerning neutrophils. In this cartoon, we see the development of the neutrophil in the bone marrow. But what happens to these cells? Where do they go? Well, developing and maturing neutrophils exist in different compartments. The largest compartment is that granulopoietic compartment in active marrow, and there's also a storage compartment in the marrow from which trillions of neutrophils are released daily. There's a small tissue compartment that obviously gets larger if necessary due to injury or infection, and a circulating population, as well as a fourth population undergoing what's called margination. Margination is a process whereby neutrophils adhere loosely and transiently along the endothelial surface in venules and capillaries. And this population is constantly interchanging with the circulating population. So why is this marginating compartment so important? Well, upon injury or infection, this population of neutrophils can be rapidly called into action through a process called demargination, which is depicted here on the cartoon. So I like to think of these cells as EMTs or first responders. They're there to try and take care of the infection or injury while other cells are being recruited. Neutrophils will enter the tissue via a selectin and integrin-driven process called diapedesis. Now, although these terms seem to describe similar processes, in fact, all immune cells undergo diapedesis. This is the way they leave the circulatory system and enter tissue, by moving between endothelial cells to get to the site of infection or tissue damage, mostly in response to chemokine signaling. Diapedesis is also called extravasation. Demargination, however, is usually thought of as a neutrophil process. Well, that's it for hematopoiesis. And though it seems daunting right now, by looking for the characteristics of each developmental stage and giving this a bit of practice, you'll soon be able to distinguish among the lineages and to identify the basic hematopoietic cell types. Thanks for stopping by.